worship to you. We come with thankful hearts in that we can depend on you for everything, because apart from you, we're nothing. Through the storm, let us focus on the water-walking Savior and depend on your strength and not ours. Keep our eyes focused on you and your word today. We need to see your glory. We need to see Jesus and to hear him say, "Peace, be still." This is the day that you've made. Give us the privilege and the pleasure to rejoice in it and enjoy you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Opening hymn is just a few pages over, 2062. He's the lily of the valley, the bright morning star. Talking about Jesus this morning.
Glory be to the Father. we have a bunch of folks over at the house, and she said to all us kids, y'all get ready to eat. And by that we knew we meant we need to at least tuck our shirt tails in before we sat at the table, wash our hands and wash our faces and do all those things to be ready to sit down at the table. And the introduction as we come to God's holy table is about preparing our hearts, washing our souls, clearing our minds, getting ourselves ready to receive that great feast that Christ has prepared for us. So y'all get ready to eat. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you in our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of need. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Good friends, hear the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That Christ died for us, even while we were sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God.
Amen.
We invite our ushers to come forward that we may worship God with God's tithes and our offerings. Holy Lord, in this act of worship, we ask that you bless the gifts and the givers to further your kingdom here on earth and us in heaven. In Christ's holy name. Amen.
Thank you.
invite you to join me in this historic confession of the Christian faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended to heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. Please do be seated. So good to see everybody this morning. I bring greetings from Rexford United Methodist Church, a little church out in the country right on the Simpson County line, about 11 miles south of us. I celebrate and pray today as we start this new relationship and partnership with them. I went down to eat breakfast with them and worship this morning, and they wanted me to make sure that I told you that they were praying for you and that they look forward to working with you in the future. And they know that Marvin's got lots of great programs, and they're going to try and come up and be a part of it. But they want you to know they got some programs, too, and they want you to come down and be a part of them on occasion. So we'll be having that in the bulletin in the future. But I celebrate, and I give thanks to God for this day of newness. Now, as I come running in a little later than usual, I've had three people say, now, this sermon's not going to be long because we still got to beat the other denominations. Since we're starting a little later. No promises, but we're going to try and make it happen. As we pray together, has anybody got any celebrations? Some good things going on?
I do,
Gigi. Yes, ma'am.
My mother had a great trip in Israel and got back safe and sound.
Safe travels. You did well. Who else?
I found out yesterday I'm getting another great niece or great nephew.
Another?
Another one. My sister was not going to have officially nine
grandkids. Y'all just manufacturing children over there. Bye-bye, Asher. I know while we were listening to the beautiful music, Asher was just attaching his mother with affection. Grandma had to pull him off.
Just like kisses.
Yes. What else? Don't forget to thank God for the little things.
One more week of school and then it's spring break.
Woo! Who's happier, the teachers or the kids?
Teachers.
I'm not getting anything out of the kids, We appreciate Miss Carrie, who does triple and quadruple duty today. She fills in for Sarah. People ask, how you doing? I'm blessed. We're blessed every day. I know that there's lots of little things, and if we want to find something to complain about, some of us have some real stuff to complain about. I think when we look to the blessings of life, it just makes life that much better. And so the things that we complain about, I know we've got some concerns. Who wants to lift those concerns up to God?
Baby, I have a cousin I've been real close to that's placed on hospice care, so just prayers for his family.
Okay, Melody's cousin. She's brought him up several times in prayer. Who else? I know that there's a lot of things going on. I know that you're holding it in your heart. We got a lot of things going on in this world. Can't do anything about Ukraine. We do have soldiers that are on the edges of Ukraine. Let's pray for them. Let's pray for peace. And we pray for our country as we have our own issues. And it's going to get tighter, I think, as gas goes up and diesel goes up. We're going to have to take care of one. Let's pray for each other in the midst of that. We pray for this new relationship with Rexford. And as COVID seems to be going down, hallelujah, I don't think we had a day over 500 this past week. You seem to be more up on that. Am I correct in saying that? And the numbers in the hospital are way down. Hallelujah. So continue to be smart and take care of yourself. Just had one person said, I don't feel so good. Stay one home. God bless you. Thank you for thinking of all of us. But let's take care of one another. And as we unite our hearts, the Lord be with you. We give you thanks for the easy times. Lord, we've been through some hard times. We're always expected to try and find faith and to celebrate life and to do what we should. But Lord, sometimes it's just easier. We give you thanks for the easiness, for the blessings, for the grace of this world. Strengthen us, God, as your congregation, that we may spend our moments, especially in the time of Lent, thinking about our relationship with you, hoping, striving, working towards living to be more like you and to have you in our lives. And even in the times where we feel like we just don't have the strength and the power to carry on, and we don't have the ability to make a difference in this larger world, Lord, let us rest in your grace. For all that we carry in our hearts that you know long before we've prayed, even knowing our unwillingness to pray, you've already prayed it for us. We lift them up for your holy touch. Strengthen us in body and mind and in soul. And Lord, when we can't do anything else, we thank you that we can pray the prayer that you taught us when you said, say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
And I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Our question this morning is, am I able to be crucified with Christ? You may stay seated.
We lose.
read from 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter is in the back of the New Testament. If you go to 1 and 2 Peter, 1 and 2, 3 John, Jude, Revelation. Way back there. Little book, only three chapters. Full of lots of instructions to the church. It's really preachy if you like preaching material. Peter kind of gets down to the message. He closes the letter up like this, saying in verse 17, "You, therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, beware lest you be carried away with the error of lawless men and lose your own stability. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity." Amen.
Thanks be to God.
Lord God, help us to grow in your grace. Amen. So Peter's instructions are, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's his instruction. Y'all ready to do that? If I were to say, let's do that, how many of you know how to do that? I mean, it's an instruction, but he doesn't say how. We spent, 2 weeks ago, we were talking about sin and how sin is part of what separates us from God. And not only does it separate us from God, but it separates us from each other. But how do we reconcile that relationship? How do we get back to God and back to each other? And it is by the gift, the blessed gift, which is
grace.
And grace is that gift that we all desperately need but don't deserve. And as we talked about grace, we said grace has multifacets to it. And there are really kind of three kinds of grace. All right, now, I don't know if we got any confirmants here, but you remember three kinds of grace? Oh, I see the fear on their faces. He's nodding his head. Yes, the first one is, anybody want to dare say? You know what? Say it real loud for everybody to hear. He knows it. He's just saying it softly. Prevenient grace. The grace that goes before us, because Christ died before our sins and for the sins of the entire world. The second grace is the grace that lines us up. It starts with a J, justifying grace. And the third grace is the grace that's moving on to perfection, as John Wesley would say. The grace that we want to be like Jesus. What were we saying back there?
Sanctifying
grace. Exactly. So prevenient grace, justifying grace, sanctifying grace. But as Methodists, we kind of lean towards one of those particular, anybody remember which one that is? Prevenient grace. Because the grace that we really want to hang on to for the purpose of our salvation is the grace that Christ gave to us as he died before all of our sins. Meaning that there's nothing that we have ever done or could ever do that's greater than what Christ has done for us. And at the end of the day, that is where our confidence lies. But it doesn't mean that we sin boldly so that grace may abound. We have to live into that grace, which justifies us. And as we try and strive for perfection, we are sanctified. All right. Enough of that review. So the grace that leads us there. Now, so Peter says, for the church to grow in the grace and knowledge of God. But he doesn't say how. We've talked about all this kind of, how do we receive this grace? What are the means? What are the methods that happen? So, have you ever been asked to do a job and nobody told you how to do it?
Yeah.
Kind of frustrating. I think that's where a lot of churches are. We're out here trying to encounter this grace, and we don't always know how to do it. We kind of know when it happens. Usually we make a mistake and somebody forgives us, and that's what we claim is grace. But in the liturgy, in the relationship of the church and worship, we have ways of encountering grace. Now, there's a big seminary where it starts with an S, that there are two ways that we encounter this grace. It starts with an S. Anybody want to, any of our confirmants want to? Not sacrifice, but close. That's one of them, but sacraments. The sacraments are the means of God's grace. They are the tools that we use to encounter God's grace in worship. And we have two sacraments that we believe in and that we practice in the United Methodist Church. The first one is communion, the Lord's Supper, the Eucharist. The second one is holy baptism. These are the means of God's grace. So these are the tools that we use to encounter God's grace. Now, it's kind of hard to say that have you encountered God's grace when you come to church, you repeat a bunch of lines like a robot, you come up and you drink old stale juice that they probably should have thrown away last month, and stale crackers. Don't y'all feel like you've encountered grace? The juice doesn't sit around that long. Becky's shaking her head. It's like, that preacher just said I let you sit around. I have gone to the cupboard and seen the mold on top of the juice before at a different church, but not here. But we come to this table. And we are supposed to, at this table, be transformed, be changed. The scripture is always talking about some kind of relationship between that which is physical and that which is spiritual. And we're supposed to be focusing on that which is spiritual. We have physical bodies, but we are spiritual beings. We have physical elements before us, but spiritually we realize they are the body and blood of Christ who died for our sins. We go through these motions time and time again to remember. And memory is very powerful. Memory is spiritual. Memory is worship. Because Jesus did this awesome thing. Absolutely awesome thing. When he got together with those disciples and on that night, and they gathered for a meal. And I want you to know, meals are sacred. Meals are special. Meals are ways that we encounter God and each other. But when Jesus got together with them in that upper room, it wasn't juice and old stale crackers. But it was a meal of memory. A sacred meal where they remembered how God saved God's people out of Egypt. It was a message of salvation. And we need to know a message of salvation. And he took that old story of Moses telling the people to kill the lamb and put the blood on the doorpost and roast it over an open fire with your shoes on your feet and your staff in your hand and be ready to go and cook the bread, but we don't have time to let it rise so it's unleavened. Remember how God saved us out of Egypt? You remember that? How God offered sacrifice with the blood of the lamb on that Passover night? And then Jesus did something. He said, I am that lamb. And whenever you get together and do this in remembrance of me. This is the tool that we use to try to encounter God's grace. Yeah, if our heart's not in it, we can just be like robots and go through the motions. But if we get ready to eat, and we prayerfully approach the altar and have combed our hair, tucked our shirt tails in, washed our face, washed our hands, and have properly prepared ourselves, we realize that it's something remarkable. The most powerful instrument of God's grace lies within us. It's a sacrament. The other one, of course, baptism. We remember and we dedicate ourselves and we dedicate others to the grace that God has already given to us. But as we come to the altar this morning, I hope that it not be stale and routine. But I think it really has a lot to do with your approach. Prayerfully, I invite you to come in. Thank you. come to the table. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right. And it's a good and joyful thing. Always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and we join their unending hymn singing. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of the suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night which he gave himself up for us, he took bread and he gave thanks to you. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of a new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is God.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Beloved, it's the body of Christ, broken for you. It's the blood of Christ, shed for you. We're going to invite our servants, if you would come first.
While the servers are coming, I was just going to emphasize the communion bell offering. If you're like me, my heart's broken when I see all those children having to leave their home and their country. So the offering of the day will go for the refugee relief for the Ukrainians.
We're going to invite our choir to come down first, and then you're able to come under the direction of the ushers. As Melody said, the monies that left here are go to an international event, United Methodist Commission on Relief. I know a lot of times Methodists don't know where their monies go, their apportionments or their mission shares or something, but as the United Church, this is what we're doing, and we're already present there. We give you thanks for your support. Thank you.
Christ's name.
Amen.
As these go, let others come.
Thank you.
rejoice that I'm receiving the means of God's grace, that the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit would go with you from both now on and forever.
Thank you.
reminds us of God's prevenient grace that went before us. Holy Communion is that grace where we have to come back time and time again, as Jesus said, do this as often as you gather in my name, that restores us and justifies us. But all of this is that we may live into God's kingdom, that we may go into the world, letting people know who Christ is in our hearts and sharing and teaching in Christ's name, and that we may live into the face of Christ, which of course is sanctifying. Living for Jesus. I invite you to stand as we sing our closing hymn, and the faith we sing, 2149. Countenance upon you and give you peace. Let all God's children.